Canola School on RealAgriculture.com is brought to you by Alberta Canola Producers Commission, SAS Canola, and Manitoba Canola Growers.
Welcome to Real Agriculture's Canola School series. I'm Kara Oosterhoes. In this episode, I talked to Michael Harding, who is a plant pathologist with Alberta Agriculture and Forestry based in Brooks. Michael and I talk at Canola Palooza in Lacombe about one of the most common diseases that affects your canola crops, sclerotinia. He also talks about scouting for sclerotinia. You actually have to get down on your hands and knees when scouting for the fungus, those little tiny mushroom structures, before they actually become the full sclerotinia, that stem rot. Because once you see that stem rot in your fields, it is actually considered too late to intervene.
Yeah, sclerotinia is one of the most common diseases in canola and other crops as well. Just about any broadleaf crop can be a host for sclerotinia. So in canola, it causes stem rot. And we see stem rot in canola fields every single year. So it's commonly occurring, and in some years it can be quite severe. So 2016 was a year where sclerotinia was common and severe.
So how can producers be scouting for it? What's the first signs of sclerotinia?
Well, for the people who aren't faint of heart, you can scout for signs that the fungus is sporulating, but you have to crawl around on your hands and knees looking for tiny little mushroom structures that are formed. A better way to sort of estimate the upcoming risk of sclerotinia is to use things like petal tests. So there's new tools available to help growers sort of estimate the upcoming risk and need to spray. But the last way to do that is to use a checklist or a decision-making tool that will just kind of ask questions like, what's your rotation? What was the last time canola was here? How bad was the sclerotinia? What's the weather forecast, etc.? And you go through a series of questions and you end up with a score that helps you make a decision as to whether or not you should spray. So scouting for sclerotinia to assess risk is really challenging, and that's why there are these tools available to help growers either use decision-making tools or petal tests or biosensors to help kind of get an idea of how bad the risk is.
So once producers actually see the sclerotinia, what can they do? What's the next step?
Yeah, so once you start to see symptoms, it's really too late to intervene. And so we have to use these predictive systems before the symptoms show up, because the fungicides only work to protect green tissue. And once we have lesions forming on the stems, it's too late. We can't cure them. So using sclerotinia tolerant varieties and fungicides at the right time when the risk is there will help. But because of the nature of sclerotinia, we probably won't ever eradicate it. We don't have complete genetic resistance, and because it can complete its life cycle on so many other crops, it's probably something we're going to have to do our best with. And as new tools and new products come available, hopefully we can get better at managing it. But once we start to see the symptoms, it's too late. The damage will be done.
And how do things like irrigation or anything like that play a role with sclerotinia?
For sure. So that's a great question. So the three key pieces are the susceptible host, the virulent pathogen, and then the third is the environment. And so through irrigation, we can modify the environment to some extent. And so that period leading up into flowering and at flowering, it's good to give irrigation in bursts that will allow the canopy to dry out a little bit. And so keeping things wet coming into flowering and at flowering isn't a great strategy for avoiding sclerotinia, because that if the soil stays wet, the apothecia form and release the spores, and then if the canopy stays wet, you get disease initiation and the lesions can start forming on the stems.
So what stage do you typically start to see that actual stem rotting on the sclerotinia?
Yeah, so the disease initiation happens during the bloom period. The spores will land on the petals and start to colonize those, and then as the petals will fall down and lodge in the notches of stems or down on the ground. And then, 2 to 3 weeks after that period, you'll start to maybe see the beginnings of some stem lesions. And then it progresses depending on the weather.
Okay. Anything you'd like to add?
I guess maybe the one thing I will add is sclerotinia is a disease that we can't just rely on one tool. We have to sort of integrate as many things as we have at our disposal. Like, crop rotation isn't going to prevent you from getting sclerotinia. Fungicides aren't going to eradicate it. We have to sort of use all the tools, especially in high-risk situations. And even then, we probably still will see some sclerotinia. So it's a challenging disease to manage.
And because it is kind of airborne, so if you'd see it in one field, can you see it, or should you be spraying in a field across the row?
That's an excellent question. Sclerotinia, when it releases spores that do, so it does eject spores that get up into the airstream and move, but they drop off pretty quickly. So if you have apothecia, let's say you have a field with a whole bunch of sclerotia in it beside a field that doesn't. Most of the apothecia germination and spore release is going to be local to that field. We're talking about meters to tens of meters and maybe hundreds of meters in the rare case, like on a day like today. for the most part, if you have a field with a high sclerotinia pressure, it's not going to contaminate the whole county. It's going to be a relatively local epidemic. So the field adjacent will be a little bit more at risk, but it's not 100% certain that the disease is going to move across the fence line.